There's only one way to get better at something, and that's with practice. So I'm going to take you through some Postgres drills to get you a little better at databases. Let's get into it. Number one is to create a table that satisfies these requirements. My table is going to be called posts, but you can build whatever you want to build. It needs to have an ID, which auto increments and is the primary key for this table. It needs a created at timestamp, which is automatically populated when a new row is created. We want a mandatory column for title, which is of type text, and then an optional column for the content of the post, which is also of type text. We want an is published column, which can store the value true or false and defaults to the false value if nothing is provided. And lastly, we want another table that references this post table by a column called post underscore ID. So to make it a little bit more realistic, this other table will probably have an ID, a created at, and then rather than title, we'll have a mandatory column for its content. So I'm imagining these are posts, like blog posts, and maybe these are comments that belong to a particular post. Okay, time to pause the video and give this a try for yourself. I'll step through the solution soon, but see if you can do it on your own. No. Seriously, I'm not going to be doing anything fun. Just pause the video. I dare you. Oh. Okay, fine. Let's step through the solution. So let's just grab these requirements and then paste them down here at the bottom and add a statement before it to say create table, and I'm going to call mine posts. We then need to provide our list of columns, which we've conveniently got as a nice little list here. We just need to uncomment them and turn it into syntax that Postgres will understand. So firstly, we need to get rid of these colons, and now we want our ID column to be auto-incrementing. Well, firstly, we need a type to actually increment, and so an int or integer column makes sense to me. I'm pretty sure there's actually a keyword for auto-increment, maybe, but you can actually collapse both the type and this statement to auto increment down into a special type in Postgres called serial. So the first post we create will be ID 1, and then the next one, ID 2 and 3 and so on. And Postgres will manage automatically incrementing that value for us. And then just to super protect ourselves from the future, which is probably not necessary in our blog example, but a good thing to call out in case you're working on a bigger system, serial will translate to an int, as we said before, which I believe is a 4-byte integer or an int 4, which if we do a quick Google search for biggest number you can store in 4-byte integer, we can see that's only about 2.1 billion, which just might not be enough space for the amount of blogs that we want to write. However, if we look at a big int, and let's say in Postgres, just to be sure, we can see big int gives us a whopping 8 bytes of space, which means we can store a ridiculous number that I don't even know how to pronounce. So back over in our project, rather than using an int or int 4, we definitely want to use a big int, which means if we want to use that serial type to get this ID auto incrementing, we just need to tell it we need a big serial to give us that extra space of an 8-byte integer. Now, 20 or 30 years ago, you would definitely not do this. It would be too expensive. And even when I studied computer science like 8 years ago, I was told to never do this, probably because the course was written 20 or 30 years prior to that. But storage is incredibly cheap these days, and so you can afford to buy yourself the peace of mind knowing that you're not going to blow out the top end of your table by writing too many blogs. So our ID column will be an 8-bit integer and auto increment all the way up to that ridiculous number, and then we just need to remove this comma to make this our primary key. Then to declare another column, we need a comma. So our created.column is going to be a timestamp, and I like to always use a timestamp with time zone just because dates and times are incredibly complicated, so I like to store as much as I possibly can in the database, like including the intended time zone for this row. And then to automatically populate when a new post is created, we just need to set the default for this row to be the result of calling the now function. So calling the now function gives us a timestamp of this moment right now. If we do that when this row is created in our table, then we get a timestamp of when that row was created at. And since this is going to be the default value, we can also say that this column will be not null because it will either have the result of that now function or whatever value is provided when we're creating that row. So it will never be null. And then we need a comma to declare our title column. Again, we don't want this colon. The type is going to be text. But since this column is mandatory, again, we're going to specify that this column will not be null. We then need a comma and our content column, which I've signified is optional with this question mark, so we can get rid of that, and also this colon. And then the default is that this column could be empty or store the value null unless we explicitly declare that it's not null. So we can just put a comma on this one, and then we have our isPublished column. Again, get rid of this colon. The type for storing the value true or false is a Boolean, and we want this one to default to the value false. And we can select this one and run it to create our post table, and then we want to create our comments table, which is pretty similar. So we can say create table comments. We want an ID that's a big serial and our primary key. We want a created at timestamp. We don't care about a title, and we want our content column to be not null. And then rather than this is published column, we want a post underscore ID. The type for this one is going to be big int because this needs to match the ID column of the post table, which again will be converted into an auto increment big int. And this one is also going to be not null, as it doesn't make sense for there to be a comment that doesn't belong to a particular post. And the way we set up a relationship between this column and the post table is say this column references the post table and specifically the ID column. Now we can highlight this statement and give it a run, create our comments table. So now we just need some example posts and some example comments. And that's drill number two. Go and insert some dummy data into each of these tables. Hit that pause button and we'll go through the solution soon. So remember, our post table has an auto incrementing ID, so we don't need to provide that. Created at is also automatically populated, and is published defaults to false. So when we insert a new row into the post table, we only need to provide a title and optionally a content value. So then the values for each of these columns can be first post, and the content for this one can be my first awesome post. And if we want to create multiple posts at the same time, we can just put this on a new line to make it a little bit clearer, and then we can do a comma and add another post and another post. We can call this one second post, and the content can be my second awesome post. And super creatively, this can be our third post and make it my third awesome post. We also need to get rid of this dangling comma at the end, and then we can highlight this and run it to insert our posts. We can then do the same for our comments. So again, our ID and created at fields are automatically populated, so we just need the content of the comment and which post belongs to. So we can just modify this statement to say we want to insert into the comments table, and the columns are going to be content and then our post underscore ID. And we can just make this first comment, second comment, third comment, and then these three can belong to ID number one. And now we can run this one to add those comments, and then add the same comments to blog number two, and run this one, and then the same comments to blog number three. And if we select all of the columns from the post table and give that one a run, we can see our three posts. And if we select each of our comments and run this one, we see our nine comments. Okay, cool. We've got some dummy data in the database. But if that insert statement wasn't really pushing you, then you're not really getting any better at Postgres. So why don't we go way over the top and see if we can do this in one mega insert statement using something called a common table expression, or CTE. So first up, let's delete each of those posts by just saying delete from post table. And if we run this one, we'll see Supabase is warning us that this is a destructive operation, and just making sure we definitely want to execute this query, which we do. Ah, and we see this error because this violates a foreign key constraint because these posts are still referenced from the table comments. Okay, this is great. Impromptu exercise. Can you delete all of the comments and the posts in one statement? If not, feel free to just delete the comments and then the posts, but give it a go. Okay, Time to show you a very bad command that you should be really careful using, because it can very quickly obliterate a whole bunch of data. So as I mentioned before, we could do the safer option of just deleting the comments. And then once we've done that, we could delete the posts. But if we, instead of deleting from the post table, want to truncate the post table, and we also cascade that truncate to any table that references these posts we're trying to delete. Now, if we run this one, and yes, we're sure we want to run this destructive query, we can see it's allowed us to delete those posts, and we can confirm that by selecting star from posts. And if we run this one, we see we have no posts. And if we try to do the same thing from the comments table and give that a run, we can see it's also empty. But please, please, please be very careful with that command. Okay, onto our CTE. If you don't know what a comment table expression is, maybe go check out the Postgres docs. Give it a pause here and see if you can implement it yourself. Or just keep watching. I know you're going to do that anyway. So a comment table expression looks like this. We use the with keyword, then we have a name for our CTE. So in this case, it's going to be our first post that we're inserting into the database. Then we say as, and then give it a statement that we want to run once, but then be able to reference this result from another statement, which will be inserting our comments. So that would look something like this, where we're inserting into the comments table, the content and the post ID for three comments that have been left for our first blog post, but we're not yet using our common table expression. And if we're working in a table that already had other rows, there'd be no way to know ahead of time what this static ID should be. And that's the benefit of our CTE, is that we're returning the ID for that specific post that we've just inserted, which we can reference as first post. So instead of the static ID 1 here, we can use a subquery to select the ID from our first underscore post. And we can copy and paste this subquery to our second comment and also our third comment. And now if we ran this query, we would be inserting a new post and then three comments for that post, all in a single SQL statement. But we want three blog posts with three comments each. Well, that's easy. We just declare multiple CTEs. So we can have this one for first post and then a second post and update the title and also the content. And then the same thing again for our third post and then remove this dangling comma. And for our comments, we can just duplicate these three and then duplicate them again. But this second set of comments can be for our second post. And then this third set can be for our third post. And again, we get rid of this dangling comma and we can probably neaten this one up a little bit so we can clearly see we're inserting our first post, then our second post, and then our third post using these common table expressions, which we can then reference when inserting our comments for our first post, our second post, and our third post. So let's give it a run just to make sure that everything's We can see this syntax error, which was my bad. We don't actually need to specify with for each CTE, only the first one. So if we read this from the top, we're saying with this first post and this second post and this third post, we want to insert each of these comments. Now, if we give this ridiculous SQL statement a run, we see success, no rows returned, which deserves some confetti because we made it through our third drill and we're now a whole bunch better at Postgres. And we can confirm we actually have those posts by selecting star from our post table. And we can see we have those three posts and we can do the same from our comments table and see we have three from our first post, three from our second post, and three from our third post. Awesome work. But if these comments are going to grow and grow and grow, that means the amount of time it takes to query a particular article is also going to grow. So it's a great time to learn about indexing. But for that, you need to check out this video right here. We take a massive table with over 10 million records and reduce the time it takes to query data by over 43,000 times. But if you just want to learn a little bit more about Postgres, there's also this super convenient playlist. But until next time, keep building cool stuff.